Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Awesome.
It is so good to see you all here. Welcome to Wild West Hackin Fest. My name is Ed Skoudis, for those of you that I haven't met. I'm wearing an outfit that was provided to me by John Strand. He asked me to dress up for him, and I always like to dress pretty for John, so here we go. True story. I mentioned this during the keynote thing this morning. This is the first time since high school that I have worn a dress.
Wow.
To which you say, when did you wear a dress in high school? Are we recording this?
Yes.
Okay. Well, all right. Go back to freshman year in high school. Freshman year in high school, I loved Cyndi Lauper, so I thought I could have no better costume than to go as Cyndi Lauper. So I dyed my hair orange, and I was Cyndi Lauper that year. Won first place in the competition for costumes. So it's like, oh yeah, I got this. All right, that was freshman year. Sophomore year, Madonna, Like a Virgin Tour came out. I got a prom dress. I made myself a boy toy belt buckle. You remember the album cover? No. My dad comes into the room. He's like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm making my Halloween costume. He's like, I'm making a boy toy belt buckle, honestly. And he's like, okay, whatever. Fast forward on that, senior year, I dress as Annette Funicello. Do you remember the Jiffy Peanut Butter and Mickey Mouse Club? So there is a photo of me as Cyndi Lauper, I don't know if you ever find it, and a photo of me as Annette Funicello. By the time you get to freshman year in college, actually I guess there is one more time that I did beyond high school, and I dressed as a blue nun. And that's enough of that. All right, so welcome to Honey, Please Don't Burn Down Your Office. This is an exact quote from my wife. As I was putting together my office over the last couple of years, she said this to me several times. Further adventures in smart office automation. All right, now previously, I did a talk about a year ago that focused on some of the development work that I had done with home automation, smart light bulbs, and so forth. How many people here saw that previous talk? All right, good. That's excellent. If you haven't seen it, don't worry. I'll get you up to speed. I got like two slides that tells you everything. This is so weird. Anyway, I got like two slides that'll kind of show you what I was doing a year ago. But this talk is focused on what I've done in the past year with the idea of sharing some ideas with you that I hope will have you starting to work on this technology too. So I always wanted to have my office kind of feel like Jarvis. Right, Tony Stark's, you know, smart digital assistant, that kind of thing. You walk into the office, you start saying things, and things start happening, moving. And my wife started this with me, actually, by buying me three Philips Hue light bulbs. Not last Christmas, but the Christmas before. That was how it started. I am now up to over 50 Philips Hue bulbs. In fact, I just got three more last week. So I'm at 53 now, okay? And the whole thing grew into an Internet of Things test bed, a development platform, and a weekend dance club. So just for me and my robot dog. So here's some of the stuff that I had deployed previously. It comes back. You promise?
Yes.
Oh, then yes, you do promise. All right, so I all started this with a Morse code key. This is from 1861. It's the real deal. It was from the war between the states. And what I did is I took a Raspberry Pi, connected it to this Morse code key, put on one of the Twitter Python APIs, and it follows me on Twitter. It just pulls down my latest tweet, and if there's a new tweet there, it just types it out in Morse code. So for the last like 4 or 5 years, anything that I tweet gets typed out in my office in Morse code. You hear it, click, 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 click. And that kind of got me rolling here. I then bought an Atwater Kent Model 80 radio from 1932, which acts as the main speaker for my office. I got an older one, a 1924 breadboard radio. That's how radios used to look like back in 1924. And I got a speaker for that, a Burn speaker from 1925. Kind of a flapper thing there, right? Westinghouse fan from 1938, so you could say turn the fan on. Look at the grill of this thing. You could fit fingers in there easy, and if you have a smaller hand, you could actually put your whole hand in there slicing the thing up. It is razor sharp. I got a model train engine that goes around my crown molding. I got a Mesmer tube, which is a 3,000 volt differential of electricity, and it kind of all lights up and looks very beautiful. I got 53 Philips Hue bulbs and some shades in the office and so forth. This is what I had about a year ago. But moving forward from there, let me show you the video I put together, the original office a year ago. And later on, I'm going to have a video of what's happened in the last year. And you're going to see how much this transformed, not only in what's in the office, but also in my thinking of it. So here we go. It's the same video I played last year, but I just wanted to get you all up to speed on what I've done.
Turn the Mesmer tube on.
That's the mesmer tube. So it's all Siri-based, right? It's not all Siri-based now. There's the 1932 speaker. I used the British voice for Siri back then because I thought it sounded more like Jarvis. Look at that thing. Listen to it. It's like a jet engine. It will cut you. I'm telling you. All right, watch this. So the lights go on, the shades go up, it starts playing my music.
Activate red alert.
Because you know, that's important, right? Because you never know when you might need to activate red alert. All right, so that was where I was a year ago. Let me tell you what's happened in the last year. Well, I started to deploy more things. A very good friend of mine did a 3D print job of a mini television. It's actually derived from a Zenith porthole TV from 1951. I have one of these. It's a TV about this big, and it has a 19-inch wide screen. It was the widest screen you could buy in a commercial television appliance in 1951. He 3D printed a little one for me, too, so now I have the big one and the little one. You can watch television shows on them. They download them from YouTube and such. It's wonderful. I got a flashing fedora hat that I got at the RSA conference a couple years ago. They had it at their party. So you could say, turn the hat on, and the hat starts to flash. I got a Nest thermostat that I'm still working on the integration with. I've got a Tesla coil that's in the shape of a ray gun. Because, right? My family got me a little animatronic bear for my birthday this year. I was at Sands Fire and this bear showed up. And I'm like, oh yeah, that's got to go in the office. Everything that I get that has some electronics in it is being gradually moved into the office. What's that? The witch next door might end up being in the office, yes. Yes. So I got a little, I started to think, once I hooked the bear up to the office, I'm like, what other animatronic toys do I have? Oh, I remember. My family bought me a little monster back in 2009 for my birthday. So I connected that to the office. I got a robot dog named Chip about 2 months ago. Chip is a delight. Oftentimes on the weekends, I turn down all the lights. I turn my music up full blast. I have a light show going on with 53 Philips Hue bulbs, and Chip and I dance. It's a little weird. All right. Oh, and then the other thing, Geissler tubes. These are tubes that are filled with various special gases, often noble gases and such like that, and you apply a 3,000 volt differential across them, and they glow. My Geissler tubes, I have 22 of them. They're from 1910. And I took four of them, put them in a box with some voltage units behind them so that you could say, turn tube one on, turn tube two on, and they turn on, as you'll see. So how did I build all these different pieces? Let me kind of show you my IoT testbed environment. This is what it looked like in 2006, for those of you who saw the previous talk. The center hubs are the Philips Hue hub, a Lutron Casita, that's for the blinds hub, and then I have a Raspberry Pi running something called Homebridge that extends Apple's HomeKit authentication to support other things that Apple doesn't even support. It can support things like Weibo and so forth. So I would use my iOS device to communicate with iCloud and use Siri to do the natural language processing, which would then come back and send requests out to the various devices. I did my code primarily in Python and sometimes in Bash where needed. Python and Bash, and I'm probably up to about 10 or 15,000 lines of code now to control all this different stuff. Excellent. Let me show you what's happened in a year. So I'm going to get rid of all the control lines, and I'm going to kind of get rid of that little thing that used to be Apple itself didn't write a GUI for you to control HomeKit because they thought each vendor would do that. So I'd use this one little special app to do that. Now it's built right into HomeKit. Moving forward, I'm just going to kind of move things over a little bit for you here. And then I got some additional devices. I got the Tesla ray gun. I got my Chip robot dog. And then I got a whole fleet of Raspberry Pis that control different things, like the Zenith television and the Geissler tubes and then the Monster and so forth. Also still the Morse Codenator and more. I got some more Philips Hue bulbs, as you can't see. And it's going to come back, right?
Yeah, it's back.
Thank you. And what started to happen is this one Raspberry Pi with Homebridge on it started to get kind of bogged down. I was running a lot of stuff on this one Raspberry Pi device. I love Raspberry Pis. I've got 10, 12, you lose count, right, Larry? I have a bunch. I don't even know anymore. I should probably know, right? Anyway, I got a whole bunch of them controlling different things, but I decided to move a lot of my functionality over to the NUC. Now, how many people here have a Raspberry Pi? All right, excellent, excellent. How many people here have a NUC? Oh, good, good. So you're familiar with the platform. It has about 5 to 6 times the performance of a Raspberry Pi at about 5 to 6 times the price. That's okay, right? Because I need that extra performance. And I'll talk more details about the NUC versus Raspberry Pi stuff in a bit. All right, now, this is my big change that I did starting in March of this year. So that was about 7 months ago. iOS is still there, and I still do use Siri sometimes. But increasingly, I'm relying on Amazon Alexa with an Echo device. So I have the Echo device itself. I've got 2 Amazon remote controls that I'm now using for natural language processing in the cloud itself. I put something called Project FOMO. If you want to develop something like this, don't forget about FOMO. FOMO is very interesting. F-A-U-X-M-O. It's a software implementation of WeMo. Okay, and you'll see why that's important for this, especially for people like us, security professionals, who don't want to burn down their house. So I'll come back to what FOMO does for me in just a bit. All right, so me sitting here can say, turn good morning on. And then it goes through the Echo up to the Amazon cloud for interpretation, comes back, and then on this device here, on my NUC, it throws all kinds of calls, turning various things in my office on. Very nice. Here's the wireless protocols that I'm using. I got Wi-Fi, Bluetooth low energy for these guys, as well as for Chip the robot dog. I've got Zigbee here controlling the blinds and the shades. So it's really a nice test environment with all different kinds of things for me to look at and explore. So here is the office architecture in 2017. So I went from the 2016 architecture of this, which I remember when I first put this on the screen last year at some conferences, people just laughed and said, that's ridiculous. This is what the Internet of Things looks like. Your homes will look like this someday, if not even more complex, right? All right, so that seemed complex for a year ago. Well, we've gone way beyond that now, okay? All right, so let's talk about some of the lessons learned in building this stuff out and some ideas I want to share with you. First, I got an Echo because I was so frustrated with what Apple was doing with Siri. They were taking my words away. With Siri, I was able to define scenes. And I had a scene called volume up. So I could just say, hey Siri, volume up. And the volume on my 1932 radio would turn up. Or I could say, hey Siri, Motown. And then Motown would start playing through my office. But what happened is, they started trying to make Siri smarter and smarter and smarter, so they took my words away from me. And I'd say, hey Siri, volume up, and it'd turn up the volume on my phone. What? No, I don't want that. Or I'd say, hey Siri, Motown. It would pull up the Wikipedia page for Motown. And the straw that broke the camel's back was Frank Sinatra. I live in Jersey, man. You don't take Frank Sinatra away from somebody who lives in Jersey. You'd walk into my office, you'd say, hey Siri, Frank Sinatra, and you'd hear the mellifluous tones of Frank Sinatra play. Not anymore. Now it brings up the Wikipedia page for Frank Sinatra. All right, you're out. We need a change, and I started to research this stuff. I was looking for something that had widespread support, that was a very dynamic development community, and the vendor behind it seemed to be more open than Apple. And I ended up going with the Amazon Echo with Alexa. Now, this at this point, somebody usually says, what about OK Google? What about Cortana? This guy. Those are all wonderful platforms. I went with this one. I'm supporting both platforms now, Siri and, well, Project Alexa, right? Now, the way that Amazon wants you to develop your own code within the Alexa ecosystem is to use something called Amazon Skills. Has anybody here ever written an Amazon skill? Okay, a few people have. You could do it that way, but there is a bit of a concern with certain kinds of skills controlling certain kinds of things. I'll show you that concern in just a minute, but I discovered Project FOMO because it actually does things a little bit differently to change that concern. So let's talk about Alexa Skills versus Alexa WeMo. You guys are familiar with WeMo, right? WeMo is by a company called Belkin. They make a whole bunch of different sort of smart things for the house, and they make other things like, you know, connectors and adapters and such. But the WeMo outlets are things that you could plug into the outlet, and then you can make an HTTP or HTTPS request to it, and it's just via Wi-Fi, and it will turn on or off the outlet. You could also read how much electricity it's used and its current status and all that kind of stuff. It's just a WeMo outlet. All right, so here's how Alexa Skills work. I talk to my Echo saying, turn the lights on. It takes all that stuff, sends it up to the Amazon cloud for natural language processing, and then it throws an HTTPS request to an internet accessible web server. Internet accessible web server. It can either be my own web server, It could be my IoT provider's web server, like Philips Hue. They have a server up that Amazon will call into. Or I could also use Amazon's Lambda, a serverless computing infrastructure from Amazon. My choice. But the point here is it has to be an internet accessible web server. I'm okay with that for my light bulbs. I'm not okay with that for my Tesla coil. That seems to me unwise, to have an internet accessible web server that turns on a Tesla coil in your office. So then I started looking at how WeMo works. And WeMo, there's a special skill capability for Amazon Echo and Alexa that works very different for WeMo. It works like this. I say to my Echo, turn the Tesla ray gun on. The request goes to the Amazon Cloud for natural language processing. But instead of an HTTPS request going directly to the device itself on the internet, instead it sends a request back down to the Echo. The Echo then sends a local HTTPS request to the WeMo device and turns it on or off. In other words, I don't have to expose that on the internet. Yes, I am going up there for natural language processing. Yes, there's a risk for that. But I like the risk profile of what's on the right more than I like the risk profile of what's on the left. Does it make sense to you? So yeah, I'm good with this for WeMo. All right, but what if I want to run arbitrary code? What if I want not just to send an HTTPS request to this little device to turn it on or off, but I want to like execute programs on a Raspberry Pi or on a NUC? What could I do? For that, I turn to Project FOMO. FOMO is written in Python 3, and it essentially implements a software version of the WeMo protocol. So now I can say turn whatever on, goes up to the Amazon Cloud interprets it, sends it back to my Echo, which then sends an HTTPS request to my NUC. On my NUC, I have a web server that's sitting there waiting for HTTPS requests to come to it, and based on the requests that come in, it activates certain programs that can do things like raise my shades, turn my lights on or off, change their color, turn on the Tesla ray gun, or whatever else, right? So this feels a lot safer to me, and I like it. I developed a lot of stuff in it. Now, when I originally started doing this project Alexification, I was a little bit worried. I had spent the previous year developing 10,000 plus lines of code all to work with Siri. And it's like, I don't want to have to do that whole thing again now to work with Alexa. So I had this idea, well, what I could simply do is write a wrapper around my Siri code so that an Alexa call gets made into this wrapper, and the wrapper just says invoke the Siri functionality. You see, all local, all in my office. And this really simplified things. It really did. So I'll say turn whatever on, it goes up to the Amazon Cloud, it sends a response back, the Echo sends an HTTPS request to an Apache server where I've got some custom code that then invokes things like turning on my hat. Pretty good? All right, so far so good. Remember this FOMO thing, it's really cool. Oh, there is a big limit though with FOMO. The syntax you have to say to it is turn this on or off, or turn on or off this, or what's the status with this, that's all I get. That said, you can do a lot with that. Turn good morning on. At first it sounds a little awkward, I'd like to just say good morning. But now I say turn good morning on, and you just get used to it. In other words, the AI, instead of us training it, it's training us. So turn the hat on, turn the television on, turn I Love Lucy on. This syntax is good enough for most of the things that I want to do, and it's a lot safer. So right after I did Project Alexification, I originally did that with that wrapper and all that stuff, all on one Raspberry Pi. So it was running all my Siri code, it was running Project FOMO, and this thing, you know, you'd say turn good morning on. The lights would come on. The blinds would start going up. Music would start playing. Not good. No. So I decided to move all that functionality over to the NUC. I did not throw out the Raspberry Pis, though. The Raspberry Pis are now controlling individual elements, and the NUC sort of orchestrates the whole thing. This helped to keep things more alive, more zippy, right? So NUC versus Pi. I say, why fight? Why argue? Both are wonderful, right? So I use the Pis for the local individual control of things. Where Pi really shines, the Raspberry Pi platform, is GPIO, right? GPIO just freaking rocks, general purpose input output. So you can just wire things to it very simply and easily. Not so much the NUC, right? The NUC really excels in the fact that for $350, you get some pretty high performance out of this device. And it's fairly small and doesn't consume much power or generate much heat. So these two, each one solves a different problem in a very good way, and I use both of them. All right, so it's not predator versus alien. They work together, of course. All right, so here's the Zenith porthole television. This is a little bit crazy how I got this thing to work. Turns out that it's very hard to find a repairman or repairwoman for a 1951 television in 2017. So we had to look all over the place. I brought it into this TV repair shop where they had a really old guy, and he said he could fix it. He spent 3 months not able to fix it. So we found another person, a hobbyist, and we drove the TV to his house, and it sat there for about 2 months, and he finally fixed it, and it's working beautifully. Let me show you if I get this little video to go here and see if it works.
Alexa.
Okay, that happened at DerbyCon before, so I was ready here, so I could do this. All right.
Alexa, turn Howdy Doody on.
Howdy Doody. Okay.
Wow.
Oh yeah. You can sing along if you want. All right, Buffalo Bob comes up. Yes. Well, how deep? All right. So that's pretty fun and weird. All right. I also put electric sheep. Do you guys know the electric sheep screensaver? It's really kind of cool and has all these swirling things. When I teach at Sands, I often put electric sheep screensaver on just to look fun and cool. Now imagine that somebody from 1951 were to see this.
Alexa, turn electric sheep on.
They would assume we're under alien invasion, right? So it plays techno music and just has this. I will often have this playing while I'm doing the whole disco scene in the office, and yeah, there we go. All right, cool. All right, back to this. All right, cool. And then that mini television can play things like I Love Lucy on this tiny little screen. What it is it's a Raspberry Pi Zero inside. The darn thing is about that big. You can see here with my hand next to it. Here's what it looks like inside. And you can control this either via Siri or Alexa, or the gentleman who gave this to me also created a web-based interface for it too. Nice, here's my Tesla ray gun. Christmas present from last year from my wife. It's controlled via Wemo. Looks really cool. It's fun. I was doing a presentation for some high school kids about 3-4 months ago, and one of the kids in the audience raised his hand, and he said, Mr. Ed, that's what they call me, Mr. Ed, is there anything you wouldn't put on the internet? And I wanted to have an answer for him. Well, of course there's things I wouldn't put on the internet, like a Tesla coil in my office. Oh, yeah, I guess I did put that. Not directly on the internet, but still. Yeah, or my furnace. Oh, I just got a nest, yeah. Oh, I'm sure there are things that I would not put on the internet, but it's not my furnace or my Tesla coil. And then the animatronics, you heard me doing this. You know how whenever you buy one of those little things where you push the button and it's like paw or something like that, starts to sing and dance? Turns out you can integrate that stuff really easy with a Raspberry Pi. You just get yourself a little relay module. These relay modules, I bought like 5 of them for $8. And essentially you connect the GPIO of the Raspberry Pi, one pin is all it takes, GPIO of the Raspberry Pi, you connect the other side out. So it's just gonna, when GPI goes on for one, I do it 200 milliseconds, that's pushing the button. Boom, it connects the two and your little dancing bear dances. All right, real simple. Or your dancing monster dances, whatever. I think for me, and my advice to you is always have a spare Raspberry Pi sitting around, because this will inspire you. You know, if you're sitting there, oh, I got this great idea, oh, I don't have a Pi, maybe you'll forget the idea, you'll never come back to it. But if you always have a Pi ready to go, there is value in always having Pi, don't you think? And you also, and I'll add to that, not only should you always have Pi, you should always have one or more of these little relay modules, because they help make other wonderful things happen. And then I got Chip, our robot dog. When I originally built the office back in 2009, I wanted to have a robot dog. And I priced out the Sony Aibo. And back in those days, Sony Aibos, remember Aibos? A-I-B-O? They cost $2,000 and they didn't do that much. I mean, for the time, that was a neat technology, but the price point was way too high. So I waited. And in 2016, a company called Wowie introduced a device called Chip, the robot dog. Chip the robot dog. I just got it about 2 months ago. There's a chocolate chip. I was thinking maybe I shouldn't buy a Chip robot dog, but when it came in the chocolate variety, I'm like, oh, I gotta get a chocolate chip, right? You can't not. Now here's the deal. They promised they would release an SDK for it on August 30th, 2017. So I was there, man. I had my robot dog. I'm ready for the SDK. It has not come out yet. It's not come out. There's no Python library for it, nothing like that. But I did a little bit of research and I found that for an earlier product from the same company, this Huawei company made a little robot called MIP, M-I-P. And before that, they did RoboSapien. Do you remember the RoboSapien? Same company. Yeah, cool. Anyway, they had a full SDK with Python library for MIP. MIP sounds a lot like chip. They rhyme. You can look it up. All right? So I thought, well, why don't I download all the command set for MIP and try to play it into chip? It's Bluetooth Low Energy, BLE. So I downloaded all the MIP stuff, I connected into chip via Bluetooth, yes, and I played one command from MIP. Nothing happened. I played a second command for MIP against chip. Nothing happened. I played a third command. Nothing happened. So I wrote a Python for loop that just said, play all commands. And I am not exaggerating here. As it was going through playing all the commands, Chip bowed down before me. He did like that. His eyes flashed and he bowed. It was awesome. You'll see it in a little bit. I got a video coming up of that. Nice. I'm still waiting the SDK, because I only have one command, which is just bow down before me. But that's not bad as a start. Geissler tubes. These are high voltage tubes introduced back in 1857 by a guy named Heinrich Geissler. And crazy mad scientists back in like the 1860s, 70s, 80s, they used to buy these things and do demonstrations of them. Come and see the power of electricity and all this high voltage stuff. They take 3 kilovolts AC. Pretty high voltage stuff. It will kill you, actually, if you're not careful with it, which is a downside, I suppose. I have 22 tubes from 1910 to 1911, and since I first built the office, I always wanted to have these tubes integrated with the office. Now, switching 3 kilovolts was impractical. I wanted to find a relay device that could handle 3 kilovolts AC, and I asked all over the place. And they're big and expensive, and I mean, you can buy them, but I wanted something small. So instead, what I do is I switch with my relay, I switch 12 volts DC. And then I have 4 separate power supplies that step up the 12 volts DC to 3,000 volts AC, you see? Unfortunately, that required me to buy 4 power supplies, but the power supplies were about $60 each, so it's not too bad. And then I had to put the power supplies somewhere, so they're behind this. Now, my worry is that somebody's going to reach behind that and get killed. So I put a little knife switch in front. Right? Now, the knife switch is not knife switching 3 kilovolts AC. That would be bad. Instead, it's knife switching 12 volts DC, so I'm switching it before it does the step up. But even then, I'm still a little worried that somebody might close the knife switch, turn it on, and reach behind it. So I put a little sign on there. Here's sort of the build pictures of the whole thing. Oh, here's Geissler tube. I put in front of the Geissler tubes, I have a picture of Geissler himself, and then a little advertisement from 1910 for the Geissler tubes. Listen to this. The Geissler tube is a distinct novelty on the American market. People who see Geissler tubes in action for the first time are so astonished by the beautiful effects obtained with the same that they exclaim in wonder and amazement. Oh, I need me some of that action. But I put this in there just in case. I got a little sign in front of the Geissler tubes that says, Mr. Tesla's high voltage AC circuits in use, danger. And I wanted to sound sort of like something would be written in maybe 1880 or 1910, so a little friendly. Kindly do not touch. All right, cool. Oh, then we have goodmorning.sh. This is the most complex piece of code I've ever written. Right? And what it is it's just a bash script that calls a whole bunch of other scripts, usually Python and such, to kind of activate things. So when you go into my office now and say good morning, first thing that happens is the blinds start going up, the lights come on, it does a little musical prelude that sounds sort of like a BBC kind of, you know, introduction to a program. I do a small little color light show while that's happening. I sense who is in the office, and I'll tell you a little bit later of how I sense who's in the office, but I'm doing it via Wi-Fi. I'm essentially sniffing and looking for the MAC addresses that are present in the office of people's phones and such. Then based on who's in the office, I will say good morning. The office says good morning. And then it follows it by the name of each person in the office. But I do the names in a pseudo-random order because I didn't want it to say, you know, if it's Ed and Jerry and Tom, I didn't want it to say that in the same order every time, right? Oh, and I also have Chip. Chip, it greets Chip in the office. It then says today's date is this. It says today's weather is this, so it tells you the weather for the day. It tells you what interesting thing happened in history, and then it's got a little encouraging or silly saying at the very end. Very nice. But I'm using Amazon Voice Service for this. This is cool. Again, takeaways from this thing, this is one of the big ones. If you need high quality, free, voice synthesis on the net, and responses to arbitrary questions, you can use Amazon Voice Service. Now, what are you giving them? You're giving them all of the voice questions that you have. Here's essentially how it works. I have created an audio file that says, "What is today's date?" It's an audio file. Then I simply registered as an Amazon Voice developer, and with curl, I'm telling you, it's bash calling curl. Curl sends a request to Amazon, taking my audio file and playing it into Amazon. Just, here's your file. Amazon sends an audio file back with the answer of today's date. I have another file that says, what is today's weather? Nobody ever hears it, right? Nobody ever hears the request because it's just an audio file I'm uploading via curl. What is today's weather? What happened today in history? Now, I haven't implemented this, but you could say, tell me a joke. This is really cool because this really opens up Amazon Alexa. And you don't even have to have an Echo to do this. You can do this entirely with bash and curl and audio files of your creation. Really, really nifty stuff. Oh, and then the magic of Simon Says. How many people here have an Echo? Do you know about Simon Says? Yeah. If you don't know about Simon Says, you could say, hey Alexa, Simon says hello. And then she'll say, hello. You say, hey Alexa, Simon says good morning. And she'll say, good morning. In other words, I could create an audio file that simply says, Simon says whatever. I play that up into Amazon. An audio file comes back of her saying what I want her to say. They take off the Simon Says part. So I can put words in Alexa's mouth. And this really opens this thing up. Holy cow, is it awesome. Nice. So here's some of the randomly selected things that she'll say when you say good morning to my office. Office activation successful. Let's rock this. Yo, 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 newsflash. CHCIHQ, that's Imperial Headquarters here, ready for business today. I dreamt of electric sheep last night. And then it just goes on. And then final greeting, and that's what I'm talking about. Or live boldly, use the force, Luke. Or my favorite, when Alexa says, that's the way, I like it, you are ready for action for that day. I actually have over 75 different initial greeting sounds. Cool. So I can sense people in the office, and the way that's working is, listen carefully to this one. I'm using TCP dump running on the NUC itself, connected to the wireless interface. So I'm running TCP dump, and I'm just dash W writing into a file. It's actually two files. What I do is I sniff for 10 minutes into one file, and then when I'm done with that, I sniff for another 10 minutes into a second file. When the second file is full of 10 minutes of traffic, I go back and I overwrite the first file. In other words, I'll always have 10 minutes worth of traffic, and then maybe some more. You with me on this? Make sense? Then, when somebody says good morning, all I do is a TCP dump dash R to read the file, pipe through grep looking for the MAC addresses. And wherever I find the MAC address, I build the file that has the name, audio, of the name of the person who's in the office. It's drop-dead simple, and it works beautifully. Is TCP dump the greatest thing ever? It really, now some of you are saying, dude, Wireshark, yes, I love Wireshark too. But T-Shark, you got T-Shark. But TCP dump is so nice if you're integrating it with like bash and such. So let me show you good morning in action here. All right.
Alexa.
Well, hold on a second. Okay, there we go. Okay, you can see Chip's eyes there.
Turn good morning on.
Okay.
That Chip just bowed before you, if you couldn't tell. All right. I put in a little delay here on purpose so that I could allow the tubes in the 1932 radio to warm up. So that's the BBC-like sound. You see the blinds going up?
Yeah, Jerry, Chip, and Glenn. Yo, yo, yo. Newsflash. It's Monday, September 18th. Right now, the house is 69 degrees with rain. Today's
so Lynn loses it here.
She cannot.
I've never seen this one.
No take two. There is no take two. All right, so I had to do some strange little hacks to make all this stuff work. I'd like to just go over some of those hacks to kind of show you the kinds of things you might need to do. I mean, this technology is pretty fresh and pretty raw, so sometimes you got to think outside the box. Sometimes you got to hack it, right? First of all, synchronizing the blinds. So I got these blinds. They're from a company named Lutron, and they're kind of cool. I've got five of them. So there's two on one window, two on another window, and one is a roller on yet a third window. And when I got them, they have a really neat thing. You can just SSH to them and tell each blind to go up. That's nice. So I wrote a little Python, SSH client in Python. Isn't Python fantastic? All right. So anyway, SSH, blinds start going up. Everybody's happy. It's all very good. The problem is this. I would connect to blind one and say go up. Then blind two and go up. Blind three and go up. Blind four and go up. Blind five. And they would go up staggered. Crap. That just doesn't look good. It's just not kite. You just want to say, blinds up, and they all go up simultaneously. So what do you do? Well, what I did is I tried to write my code to run faster. Right? Is there ways I can optimize it? How can I make SSH go faster? How can I make everything faster? I still couldn't do it. So then I thought, multi-threaded Python. How many people here have coded in multi-threaded Python? You're better than me. I tried. What a disaster that was. Anyway, if you can do that, that's wonderful. I did it, and it still wasn't going fast enough. You could still see a distinct inch or two in each blind because it was staggered behind the previous one. So I'm frustrated. I'm really bummed, sitting in my office. And then I had a remote control for the blinds, though. So I push the button on the remote control, and all the blinds go up at the same time. So I look at the logs. And the logs from the Lutron Casita device said, device 4, just push button 1. So I SSH'd into the box and said, I'm device 4, and button 1 was just pushed. All the blinds go up at the same time. No multi-threaded Python, nothing. Look at the logs. Look at the logs. That's all it was. I just say, I'm device 4, button 1, go. Nice. Next, dealing with the FOMO 90, there's a bug in Project FOMO that it can only handle up to 90 devices and then it starts kind of crapping out. So it just doesn't learn new devices. So what do? Well, you do 2 instances of FOMO, or 3 or 4, right, on different machines so you can keep performance up. So that's what I did there. Listen to this. How many people here have Philips Hue bulbs? Okay, how many people control them using the P-Hue Python library? Excellent, you should. Really, if you have some Philips Hue bulbs, you might as well get, it's P-Hue, P-H-U-E. I learned something about the PU library, though. The PU library works this way. As you add more and more and more bulbs, each bulb gets a unique, well, number assigned to it. The numbers start at 0 and go up through 63. Fair enough. So I'm right now 0 through 52. What I did is I, you know, define these things, and I can call them, and all that stuff is wonderful. But then if you delete a bulb in the middle, suddenly the library stops working. It just doesn't work. It's a bug, and it's a really, really deep bug. I tried to fix the bug. I could not. It's really deep in all this crazy detailed Python. And I didn't know why the bug was there. But I ultimately found out it's because it expects there to be contiguous device numbers. So, and now, here's the deal. You can't assign a device number. So what I had to do is I had to add new devices until it went above 63 and wrapped, and then it filled in my hole. That's an ugly hack. I'm here to tell you it's an ugly hack. But you do what you got to do, right? Right? Amazon voice remote. Oh, how many people here have an Amazon voice remote for their Echo? Yep. You know, if you read the documentation, it says you can have one and only one of those. Only supports one. Well, I didn't see that. And I bought 2. So I had one, and it was working just great. And I had my second one. I'm like, crap, I wasted the money. I'm going to have to send it back. And I'm like, meh. What the heck? Why don't I set up, so the voice remote, the way this works is you push the button and you talk into it and it sends it to your Alexa. If she's like very far away or if it's really loud outside, you can't say, hey Alexa, blah, blah, blah. You can talk into the voice remote, which in the office when it's busy and stuff, I want to talk into the voice remote and I needed 2 of them. So for my second one, what I did is just on a whim, I said, I'm going to set up my second remote as a Bluetooth speaker. And I did, and guess what? It works as a remote. Yes! You know, you're sitting in your office drinking and you get these ideas. And anyway, and then the mess of Raspberry Pi audio drivers. Raspberry Pi audio drivers are really quite ugly. No offense, I know a lot of people work very hard on them within, you know, Linux and different, Jesse and Wheezy distributions of it. But it's hard to, if you want to have a Raspberry Pi doing solid audio for months on end, I was not able to make that reliable. When I moved to the NUC with the exact same code running on Ubuntu on the NUC, the audio never cuts out. It's just, it's flawless for months, for months. All right, so those are some other little tips there. Backup strategy. Oh crap, you know how we always say you should do backups? I would manually backup all my code every week or two, you know, when I thought it was good. And then one day, I accidentally typed, I thought I was in /temp. Yeah, you know where this is going. rm-rf star. Holy crap, I just deleted all my code. And this was a very, very productive 2-week development cycle since my last backup. So now I do a cron job every day, just back up all my code, and I write it to a thumb drive, right? So do that. It's really trivial to do. I just use tar, and I have it scheduled as a cron job. You must do that. Oh, when I first built my steampunk office, this is a whole steampunk office, right? In 2009, there were 6 things that I put on hold because the technology either wasn't ready yet or my skills weren't up to it. Voice control was one of them. We got that with Siri and now with Alexa. A robot dog, I got that now with a chip. Geissler tube that turns the lights on and stuff, I got that now. A sensor to detect who's in the office, got that now. And I'm not going to tell you what 5 and 6 are. Maybe next year, all right? All right, so let me show you the office. Here it is in action.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, the chocolate.
Alexa, turn the monster on.
Those are Holiday Hack Challenge clothespin figures, by the way. My kids make those for me every year.
Turn the bear on. Hold your breath. Make a wish. Count to three. Come with me, and you'll be in a world.
So you can see my view of my own office has changed since AC/DC and the Mesmer Tube, right? Turn the Tesla ray gun on. You can sing along if you want.
Alexa,
volts AC, controlled by a Raspberry Pi, controlled by Alexa. What could go wrong?
Alexa, turn 2-3 on.
There's nothing to...
I'm going to skip forward just a little bit. And here's my boy. Snoop Chippy Chip. There. All right, so, oh, thanks. So, you're very kind. My vision of my office is changed now. I want to set it up so that there's almost like these little digital beings that inhabit the office and kind of move around and live their own lives and interact with us. Chip, and I got a Cosmo, another little robot a couple of weeks ago, C-O-Z-M-O, really nice, great Python libraries for that sucker. All right, so some advice for you, some recommendations. Stay sharp. I think every technical InfoSec person should spend some time every single day writing code. Yep. Now you say, but I don't code. Well, if you spend time every day writing code, that'll fix that problem, won't it? Yeah. Maybe it's 5 minutes. That's all I ask, just 5 minutes. It might be an hour, it might be 2 hours, but just it will make you think better, more clearly. It'll help you to better understand things. So you say, no, I'm not a coder. I'm not expecting you to be a coder. Just now, if you say, I don't even know what language to learn, learn Python. It's really simple, and there's so much powerful stuff there. You say, I don't know what to write. Paul Asadorian and I were talking about this a couple weeks ago, and he's like, well, write a port scanner. Well, you're like, yeah, but I'm going to use Nmap. Of course you're going to use Nmap, but write a port scanner, because in just writing one, you could probably do it in Python in maybe 20 lines of code, maybe 50 at the max. It will make you a better user of Nmap. You'll better understand what Nmap is actually doing for you. Pick a project. It can be simple. Code every single day. You code every day, right, Matt?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I've been coding every single day for the last 2 years, and it's made me a better information security professional. I'm telling you. Cool. By the way, there's a great book called Dive into Python that is free, or you can buy it also if you'd like, if you'd like a printed copy. You should also be purposeful. Schedule time with yourself every week. Like, now, I'm not talking to 5 minutes a day when you're writing code, or an hour, whatever it is. I'm talking every week, set aside some time to work on a project. Maybe it's a CTF, something like that, for a couple of hours. You might say, every Saturday at 10 a.m., I'm going to spend 2 hours working on some project, some CTF or something like that. And Aman Hardikar has a great series of free CTFs that he points to from this mind map. And you definitely should check that out. Now, thoughts on IoT and office security. I'm really terrified that any update of any of the firmware on any of my devices will blow up one of my APIs that I'm desperately dependent on. But you gotta keep it up to date. You really have to keep it up to date. I also use a lot of SSH with key-based authentication. SSH with key authentication is nothing short of a miracle. Next time you use SSH with key authentication, thank Tatu Yalonen, the guy who created SSH. Do you know that Tatu, T-A-T-U? Amazing stuff that he has given to the world. And then the whole Open SSH project really fulfilled that promise. Getting Linux permissions set just right is hard. Let me just tell you that. All right? Also, here's the most important lesson of all. Secure it as you build it. When you're developing stuff like this, it gets so fun and so exciting to just move forward to the next thing and the next thing and the next thing that you say, oh, I'll come back and secure it later. There is no later. You secure it as you build it, or you will never secure it, because there's so much more other stuff to do, so much more fun stuff. It's like the three little pigs. Do you remember the green jelly video? Little pig, let me in. Not by the hair of my chinny. Thank you. Chinny chin chin. Exactly. You got to be like the third pig. Build your house out of cement, right? You know that, Larry, right? Yeah, it's classic. All right. I'd love to hear your ideas. Some additional ideas that I have. I'm going to get a laser and just do it. I've got to watch the eyes, though, so it's going to be shining on the ceiling, right? So laser, I'm going to be hacking Chip's BLE interface, Chip's RF interface, and Chip also has an infrared interface that I'm going to be talking to Larry about. And Larry's going to come and visit the office so we can work on this together. So, all right. I think we have time for maybe one question or two. Yes, yes, sir. Real quick. I do work from home. That's a really good point. Do I have any concern about Amazon listening into our conversations while I'm talking about a client? Yes, I do. Now, they say that they will not send it across the net until they hear Alexa. Now, you can reconfigure that, though, and say, send it up to the net already for interpretation, even if I don't say Alexa. The problem is, even with that functionality configured so it'll only send it up when it hears Alexa, it hears Alexa all the time, even when there is no Alexa. Now, it's got a little button on the top that you can push to mute the microphone. And I recommend strongly that you mute the microphone if you're going to have a sensitive conversation, right? But that is a concern, definitely. Other questions? Can we get PCAPs for all this? Real simple PCAPs, yeah. So conclusions, build yourself an IoT lab. It's fun. There's so much going on in the IoT space. Web, cloud, networking, embedded, projectors that work. It's incredible. Crypto, host security, coding, packets. And then one more thing. Holiday Hack Challenge 2017 is coming. Oh, I'm telling you, there are people working so hard on this right now. It is unbelievable. I don't want to point fingers, but there are people who are like dying for this right now. And so this year's story is epic. You want to hear this year's story? I'll bet you do. So I'm telling you, Santa Claus has given us behind the scenes access to the North Pole. There will be an epic battle there where someone is trying to destroy the entire North Pole forever. And you have to save the North Pole so that you can save Christmas. In 2016, you saved Christmas 2016. In 2015, you saved Christmas 2015. You have to save all subsequent Christmases now. We really upped the stakes here. You got to find out who the bad guy is, why they're trying to destroy the North Pole, how they're trying to destroy the North Pole, and you're going to have to hack through all kinds of wonderful stuff. We have a new video game, and I think you're going to like it. It's completely free. It launches approximately, Ron, what's the date? December 8th, 2017. Thank you, Ron. And seriously, we give this away as a gift to the community because, you know, we love you guys and we want to support you guys in developing your skills. Have fun with it. HolidayHackChallenge.com. We keep all the old ones up. So if you want to practice, how can I practice now? Do 2016. All the answers are up. Do 2015. You can go back to 2014. I've got like 15 years of these things out. We've been working on this one for over a year. The storyline for this came over a year ago. I already have the 2008 storyline in my head too. So, or 2018 storyline in my head too. So we're working on it. All right, well, thank you guys so much for your time. I appreciate it.